A very good morning to one and all. Hope my voice is clear. If it is not audible, please type in the chat box. Okay. So we'll be continuing with our lesions of visual pathway. So till yesterday, we discussed about these lesions of visual pathway. A quick recap of yesterday's class. So whatever the fibers of this temporal half of the visual field come and fall on the nasal side. The nasal half of the visual field falls on the temporal retina. Superior rays fall on the inferior retina and the inferior rays fall on the superior retina. So that is the concept you have to remember. These nasal fibers cross over to the opposite side. Temporal fibers remain on the same side. So these are the various lesions which are produced based on the locations of the lesions. Okay. And inferior nasal fibers, they take a bend in the proximal part of optic nerve on the other side and they traverse back. That is known as von Willebrand's knee. And when the von Willebrand's knee is affected, a junctional scotoma is produced. Okay. And coming to here, pie in the sky and pie in the floor. So the temporal lobe, which is located inferiorly, it carries the inferior fibers which subserve the superior visual field. Hence, any temporal lobe lesions give a pie in the sky appearance. And similarly, any parietal lobe lesions, as they carry the superior fibers which subserve the inferior visual field, they give a pie in the floor appearance. Okay. And then homonymous and heteronymous. Homonymous means when both visual fields of the same set, that is right set. In this 5, 6 and 7 you see, only the right side of the visual field is affected. So such kind of a thing is known as a homonymous. Homonymous means either the right half or the left half of the visual field is gone. So 5, 6, 7 lesions, 8, 9, 10, all these are homonymous type of hemianopias. And this 8 and 9 are quadrantanopias, homonymous quadrantanopias. Whereas this binasal and bitemporal, they are known as heteronymous. Heteronymous because both nasal and both temporal are involved. Homo means same side. Okay. So I have to study about that. So one more thing is Wernicke's hemianopic pupil. So this is a condition which is seen in case of lesions of optic tract. So here you see optic tract is this one, number 5. So if this optic tract is involved, what happens is temporal fibers of this eye and nasal fibers of the other eye are damaged or they do not carry any impulse. So I told you that the optic nerve also carries fibers from the pupil. That is, the pupillary fibers also pass to this optic nerve and optic tract. From this optic tract, they separate into superior brachium and they go to a pretectal nucleus. So here what it happens is, whenever there is a lesion of the optic tract, the pupillary fibers, which are coming from the nasal half of the pupil of this eye, a temporal half of one eye and nasal half of other eye, they get paralyzed. Hence, pupillary reflex occurs only when the rays of light fall on the remaining half of the retina, which is working. Okay, so Wernicke's hemianopic pupil is nothing but, so you have to know the basics of pupillary reflexes. So what is a pupil reflex? Whenever you throw light on the eyeball of the, whenever you throw light on the eye, there is constriction of the pupil. What is pupillary reflex? Direct reflex is, whenever you throw light on the eye, there is constriction of the pupil. That is known as pupillary reflex. So when there is a lesion of this optic tract, the impulses of this light from this temporal half of this eye and nasal half of the other eye are completely interfered, or they don't go up to the pretectal nucleus, or they don't go to the visual cortex. As a result, what happens is when light is thrown on this particular half, that is this temporal half of this eye and nasal half of this eye, there is no pupillary reflex. But when light falls on nasal half of this eye and temporal half of the other eye, there is pupillary reflex. So hemianopic pupil. So when the in hemianopia, what happens is the vision of the person is something like this. So when the vision of the person is something like this, so when the light falls on this particular half, that is this white area only, there is pupillary reflex occurs. When light falls on these dark areas, that is the other parts of the retina, where the pupillary fibers from the optic tract lesion is present, the pupillary impulses are not conducted to the pretectal nucleus and there is no pupillary reflex. So Wernicke's hemianopic pupil means any patient who has a hemianopia, when the light falls on the seeing area of the retina only, there is a pupillary reflex. When the light falls on the anopic area of the retina, there is no pupillary reflex. Okay. And homonymous means same side. Either the right half, in both eyes, the right half is gone, or both eyes, the left half is gone. That is known as homonymous hemianopia. So homonymous means, here if you see this one, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, all these are homonymous. See, in both eyes, the right half is gone. In this eye also right side, and this eye also right side. So that is known as homonymous hemianopia. Okay. And similarly, congruous. Congruous means it is symmetric in extent and intensity. So it is of the same size. The hemianopia or the anopic visual field is symmetric in size and symmetric in intensity. So optic tract lesions are usually incongruous. whereas the visual cortex lesions are usually congruous. Okay, so again in the same diagram, if you see optic tract lesions number 5, that is usually incongruous. That is, this half may be more in size and this half may be less in size. This one may be more dark, this one may be less dark. So that is because of difference in arrangement of the nerve fibers. But in case of cerebral cortex lesions, it is always a congruous type of hemianopia. Okay, in optic tract it is incongruous, whereas visual cortex lesions are congruous. That is, both sides the extent of anopic area, that is the extent of that scotoma or black area, is same in size, shape and depth. Okay, and lateral geniculate body and optic radiations and visual cortex pupil reactions are spread. So this is one important point. So pupillary reflex, what happens, I told you, is that pupillary fibers come up to the optic tract. From the optic tract, they go to the pretectal nucleus. So any lesions of the optic tract, the pupillary reflexes are impaired. But any lesions from the lateral geniculate body, pupil reflexes are intact. So that is how you can localize. So a patient comes to you and he says that he has got a homonymous hemianopia. He is not able to see the right half of the visual field. So the lesion could be either serial number 5 here, 5, 6 or 7, or it could be serial number 10. That is radiations, optic radiations can be involved. So if you want to differentiate whether the lesion is in the optic radiation or lesion in the optic tract, simply examine his pupils. If his pupillary reflex is normal, it is a lesion of the optic radiation. Because pupillary fibers exit from this optic tract and they go to the pretectal nucleus. Suppose the pupillary reflexes are impaired and the patient has got a homonymous hemianopia, then it is a lesion in the optic tract. So that is how you can differentiate. So lateral geniculate body and optic radiations and visual cortex, they do not have any pupillary reflex and hampering. There is a pupillary reflex intact in that. So that is how you have to learn about that. So pupillary reflexes are intact for lateral geniculate body, optic radiations and visual cortex. And then up to lateral geniculate body, descending optic atrophy takes place. So optic atrophy is a condition. What is optic atrophy? So you have learned about this orthograde degeneration and retrograde degeneration of neurons in your physiology. So suppose there is a lesion of this optic tract somewhere here in this point number 6. Then there can be two things. One is orthograde degeneration and the other is retrograde degeneration. So the degeneration of the neurons can pass from this point number 6 to point number 5 or point number 6 to point number 7 in this diagram. So what happens is here, this ganglion cell layer is the second order neuron, I told you, which start from the retina and they go up to the lateral geniculate body. So any lesions of this optic tract, what happens is the degeneration can go in an orthograde way and it can go up to the retina and it can damage the ganglion cell and thereby lead to optic atrophy. Whereas any lesions of the lateral geniculate body, the degeneration does not pass to the neurons of the optic tract. Why? Because there is a synapse between the neurons of this lateral geniculate body, that is the third order neurons and the second order neurons in this lateral geniculate body. That's why any lesions of the lateral geniculate body and above, they do not produce any descending optic atrophy of the second order neurons, because there's a synapse occurring in this between 0.6 and 0.7. If any lesion is present in this 0.6 or 0.5, that is optic tract, there is a descending type of optic atrophy is seen. Okay, that concept is important. You read it once or twice, you'll understand. Okay, so beyond LGB, there is no optic atrophy because there is a synapse between the second order neuron and the third order neuron. But up to lateral geniculate body, descending optic atrophy can be seen because they are second order neurons. Okay, so that is one thing. So optic radiation lesions sometimes spare the macula. Similarly, visual cortex lesions, they produce congruous. I told you, any visual cortex lesions, they produce congruous hemianopia. That is, the extent of the scotoma, size and symmetry is same. And it is a homonymous type of hemianopia. Homonymous means both half of the same side. Either the right or either the left side are affected in case of homonymous type of hemianopia. And in tip of occipital cortex, a macular defect occurs, which is a homonymous hemianopia. In this diagram, I have shown you yesterday. So tip of occipital cortex here. And if the tip is involved, there is only the entire macula can be involved, or there can be homonymous hemianopia like this one. Okay, usually it can be like this, or it can be homonymous hemianopia also. The diagram is not here. So in this macula only, it will be like a homonymous hemianopia. The diagram is there in your Khurana textbook. Okay, so that's about that. So that's about the visual cortex and its lesions. That is the visual pathway and its lesions. You have to read it many times in order to get a clear idea. Once you know the arrangement of nerve fibers, then it is all clear for you. You can write it on your own. Okay. Next, coming to the next important topic about pupillary reflexes. So pupillary reflexes are initiated by the rods and cones. So briefly to say, in a skeletal framework, pupillary reflex is nothing but when you throw a torch light or a ray of light into your eyes, you can see there is contraction of the pupil. So whenever you throw light into your eyes, there is constriction of the pupil. So in briefly to say, that is a pupillary reflex. And what is a direct pupillary reflex? What is a consensual reflex? What is an accommodation reflex? All these things we'll be dealing in detail. You might have learned all this in your first year physiology also. So pupillary reflexes is initiated by the rods and cones because they are the photoreceptors. So what is the stimulus for the pupillary reflex? So any reflex has got an efferent pathway, a pupillary a center, and an efferent pathway. Let it be a spinal reflex or deep tendon reflexes or superficial reflexes, jaw jerk, knee jerk, or whatever it may be. Any reflex has got a sensory end organ, an efferent pathway, a reflex center, and an efferent pathway, and an effector or the motor organ. So here, these rods and cones, they are the photoreceptor. Here the stimulus is the light. So light is the stimulus for the pupillary reflexes. The sensory end organ for light is rods and cones. That is, the stimulus falls on the rods and cones. The efferent pathway is your visual pathway. That is the retina, optic nerve, optic chiasma, optic tract, lateral geniculate body, and all these things. They are the efferent pathway. And the center for the pupillary reflex is the pretectal nucleus. And from the pretectal nucleus, efferent pathway is by the oculomotor nerve. That is the third cranial nerve. And the effector organs or end organs are your constrictor pupillae muscles in the pupil or sphincter pupillae muscles. Okay. And here again, the temporal fibers go to the ipsilateral pretectal nucleus. I told you, just like as the efferent pathway is same as the visual pathway, the temporal fibers remain on the same side and then go, they relay in the pretectal nucleus of the same side. As the nasal fibers cross in the optic chiasma, the nasal fibers from the pupillary pathway, they go to the contralateral pretectal nucleus. This is same as the visual pathway. And next, there is an internuncial neurons which connect the east pretectal nucleus with Edinger-Westphal nucleus of both sides. We'll see this in the diagrammatic representation. So here you see, light is the stimulus. I told you any reflex has got a stimulus. So the stimulus here is the light. After stimulus, there should be a sensory end organ. So that is the photoreceptor, rods and cones here in the retina, which is the sensory end organ. And from here, what happens? Efferent pathway. So efferent pathway is the ganglion cell layer. So ganglion cell layer comes to the optic nerve, from the optic nerve to optic chiasma, optic tract, from there to the pretectal nucleus. So here from the optic tract, they go towards the pretectal nucleus. From pretectal nucleus is the center here. So light is the stimulus. Rods and cones in the retina are the sensory end organ. Efferent pathway is your optic nerve, optic chiasma, optic tract, and pretectal optic tract. And then the pupillary reflex center is your pretectal nucleus, this oval-shaped structure here. And then the Edinger-Westphal nucleus can also be, it is usually comes in the efferent pathway. Pretectal nucleus is the center. And from there is an interneuron. From there, Edinger-Westphal nucleus onwards, it forms the efferent pathway, which comes to the sensory, it comes to the motor end organ, that is the sphincter pupillae muscle here. Okay. So now what happens is, just like your visual pathway, the temporal fibers remain on the same side, this green color thing, and this red color, that is the nasal fibers cross over to the opposite side. So the red color one. So just like your visual pathway, the pupillary fibers also, temporal fibers remain on the same side, nasal fibers cross over to the opposite side. So that thing you have to remember. But the only difference from the visual pathway is that visual pathway goes to the lateral geniculate body and from there to visual cortex. But for pupillary reflexes, from the optic tract, these fibers form a structure known as superior brachium. And from there, the fibers go to the pretectal nucleus in the midbrain. So that is where there is a diversion between the pupillary reflex pathway and your visual pathway. Okay. So now, what happens here is the pupillary reflexes, it comes like this. So efferent pathway. It comes to the pretectal nucleus. From pretectal nucleus, what happens is there is a neuron called as an interneuron. So this interneuron, what it does is it connects with both the Edinger-Westphal nucleus, that is both the right side and the left side. And from there, different impulses pass. They go to the ciliary ganglion. Ciliary ganglion is located in the orbit where the parasympathetic pupillo motor fibers relay. These fibers relay in the ciliary ganglion. And from there, postganglionic fibers come and they supply the pupillary sphincter. So when there is a ray of light falling on the retina, they go to the optic nerve, optic chiasma, pretectal nucleus, interneurons, Edinger-Westphal nucleus, from there oculomotor nerve, ciliary ganglion, sphincter pupillae, and there is constriction of the pupillae. So if you throw light only in one eye, suppose you throw light in one eye, so this efferent pathway, what it happens, these temporal fibers, they cause constriction of pupil in this eye. As these interneurons are also connecting with the opposite Edinger-Westphal nucleus, there is also constriction of the other eye pupil. So here what happens is, whenever you throw light in one eye, the impulses go to the optic chiasma and optic tract. And as this this has got a bilateral representation. You see this nasal temporal fibers are remaining on this side, but nasal fibers are crossing. And again, these temporal fibers again, from the pretectal nucleus, the interneurons are connecting to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus of both the sides. And so this impulse is passing through efferent pathways of both the eyes. That's why what happens is, though you throw light only in one eye, there is constriction of the pupil in that same eye as well as also the other eye. So here you see there is a bilateral connections between both the reflexes. So the pupillary reflex pathway, they have come up to this pretectal nucleus. From this pretectal nucleus, the interneurons connect to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus of both the sides. So if you throw light only in the right eye, the impulses go to the efferent pathway of both the right eye as well as the left eye. So that's why there is a constriction of pupil in the same eye as well as the other eye. So when you throw a light into one eye, constriction of pupil in the same eye is known as the direct light reflex, whereas constriction of pupil in the other eye is known as consensual light reflex. Okay. So basically there are two types of pupillary reflexes. One is the direct light reflex, the other one is called the consensual or indirect light reflex. In direct light reflex, what happens is when you throw light into one eye, there is constriction of pupil in the same eye. That is called direct light reflex. What is indirect or consensual light reflex is when you throw light in one eye, there is constriction of pupil in the other eye. That is known as consensual indirect light reflex. So why there is a consensual indirect light reflex? There are two reasons for this. One thing is the nasal fibers decussate in the optic chiasma, thereby stimulating the pretectal nucleus of the opposite side. That is reason number one. And reason number two is the pretectal nucleus of each side has got an interneuron which connects to the efferent pathway of both the sides. That is Edinger-Westphal nucleus of the third nerve, oculomotor nerve of both sides. So that's why it has got a bilateral representation. So direct reflex is a constriction of pupil on the same side, whereas indirect reflex is constriction of pupil on the opposite eye when the light falls in one eye. So that is what known as pupillary reflex. So that is about the direct and indirect. Indirect is also known as consensual light reflex. So that is the first reflex. The second reflex is the near reflex. So this near reflex is nothing but, I hope I have told you in your squint classes also. Suppose you are looking at a far off object and when you suddenly want to look at a near object. Suppose you are looking at a far object and when you suddenly want to look at a near object, what happens is there is convergence of both the eyeballs, there is constriction of the pupil and increase in anterior lens curvature. So whenever you want to look at a far object and from there whenever you want to focus on a near object, there is a condition which is known as the accommodation. So what is this accommodation? That is also known as near reflex. It is called near reflex because when you want to focus on a near object after looking at a far object for some time, then this near reflex or accommodation reflex comes into play. So this accommodation reflex has got three things. First component is convergence of both the eyeballs. Second thing is constriction of the pupils. Third thing is increase in anterior lens curvature. All this is in order to increase the power of the eyeball so that the near objects can be clearly seen. So the details regarding accommodation and its anomalies will be dealt clearly in your refractive errors chapter. So for the time being, you remember there's a reflex known as accommodation reflex, which is also known as near reflex. In this accommodation reflex, what is the principle is whenever you are looking at a far object and you suddenly want to look at a near object, this near reflex comes into action. As per this near reflex, what should happen is both the eyeballs should converge, there should be constriction of the pupil, and there should be increase in anterior lens curvature. So this is what happens in case of a near reflex. Okay. So in this one, the first part, convergence of both the eyeballs. We'll see. Constriction of pupil, the mechanism is same as like your direct and indirect light reflex. No differentiation between that, except a minor differences, which I'll tell you later. But convergence of both the eyeballs, the efferent pathway is not yet elucidated. It is assumed that the medial recti muscles, proprioception impulses pass by a third nerve to the mesencephalic nucleus of fifth cranial nerve, and from there to a prism to convergent center in tactile nucleus, and from there to Edinger-Westphal nucleus and third nerve and to constriction of the pupil. So this is not that important for you. You just remember that the efferent pathway is like in convergence reflex, there is a constriction of the pupil. So when there is a near reflex, the eyeballs converge. So when the eyeballs converge, the medial recti muscles of both the eyes contract. So when the medial recti muscle contract, it sends an impulse to the third nerve nucleus to the fifth cranial nerve's nucleus, that is a trigeminal nucleus, and from there to a center in the tactile area, from there to Edinger-Westphal nucleus, and from there the efferent is common like your pupillary reflex pathway. So the only difference in convergence reflex is, it is also under research, it is not fully yet elucidated. It is assumed that when there is a convergence of the eyeballs, the medial recti muscle contract, and the proprioception fibers from medial recti pass to the fifth cranial nerve nucleus, and from there they go to the tactile region, and from there to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus and third nerve. This is still in research and it has not been completely proved. Okay. And then accommodation reflex. This is little important. In accommodation reflex, what happens is there is increase in anterior lens curvature. Lens is usually flat, but when you want to focus at a near object, the lens anterior curvature increases. So why that happens is, when there is an image blur on retina due to shift of gaze. So when you are looking at a far object and when you suddenly bring the object near, but your eyes are still looking at that, you get a blurring of the image. So when you get a blurred image, the impulses go to the visual cortex. From the visual cortex, the impulses go to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus and from there to the third nerve. And from there, they go to the ciliary muscle. As the ciliary muscle contracts, there is relaxation of the zonules and there is increase in anterior curvature of lens. So accommodation reflex, here the retinal image blur is the main stimulus here. So when you are looking at a far object and you look at a near object all of a sudden, there is a blurring of the image on the retina. So when there is a blurring of the image, from the visual cortex, the impulses go to the third cranial nerve and from third cranial nerve to the ciliary muscle, which contracts. And when ciliary muscle contracts, the zonules relax and there is increase in anterior curvature of the lens. So this is about accommodation reflex. So that is about the pupillary pathway. So you have to remember this diagram in your mind for all practical purposes. So unless you remember this, you can't understand the abnormalities. So any reflex has got a stimulus, which is light. There is a sensory end organ, photoreceptor, rods and cones, afferent pathways by the optic nerve, optic chiasma, optic tract, pretectal nucleus, and interneurons. And pretectal nucleus is the center. And from the afferent pathways, interneurons, Edinger-Westphal nucleus, third cranial nerve, ciliary ganglion, and to the sphincter pupillary muscles, which are the end organ. So this pathway you have to remember. You have to remember nasal fibers are crossing, temporal fibers remain on the same side, just like a visual pathway. And one more thing is, these are interneurons from the pretectal nucleus, which connect the Edinger-Westphal nucleus on both the sides. So this thing you have to remember to know about the abnormal reflex. So what are these abnormal reflexes? First one is amaurotic light reflex. Amaurotic light reflex means the eye is totally blind. So there is no pupillary reflex. So in blind eye, what happens is the pupil remains dilated. In any dead person, you see how you declare death of a patient. So there are many signs, but one of the signs for declaring death of a patient is fixed dilated pupils. When the pupils are fixed and dilated, it means the brain is no more alive. So brain dead, if you want to certify that a patient is brain dead, along with optokinetic nystagmus, that is doll's eye phenomena, along with doll's eye phenomena, pupillary reflex is also observed. So amaurotic light reflex means there is optic nerve or retinal lesion on the affected side and there's total vision loss. So there is no reflex of the pupil. So that is amaurotic light reflex. That means even you throw the light, there is no constriction of the pupil, either direct or indirect. That is one thing. And second thing is efferent pathway defect. So efferent pathway defect, there is absence of both direct and consensual in one eye. It is in drug mydriasis. So efferent pathway consists of your third cranial nerve. So if there's a third cranial nerve palsy on both the sides, so in both the sides, what happens is totally both the eyes, there will be no more pupillary reflex. Suppose only one side, there is a third nerve palsy. So in that side, direct and consensual reflex, both will be absent. And then drug mydriasis. So if you suppose you introduce some mydriatic drugs like tropicamide or phenylephrine or atropine. So due to that, the muscles are paralyzed and the pupil is dilated. It doesn't get fixed. And similarly in sphincter paralysis. Paralysis of the sphincter pupillary muscle also, there is no more constriction of the pupil. Okay. And Wernicke's hemianopic pupil. I told you optic tract lesion. When light falls only on the seeing area of the retina, there is constriction of the pupil. When light falls on the non-seeing area of the retina, there is no constriction of the pupil. That is Wernicke's hemianopic pupil. Okay. So amaurotic light reflex, there is no vision at all. So there is no constriction or no dilation, no constriction, just like your dead person. And then efferent pathway defect, there is absence of both direct and consensual reflex in that particular eye. Suppose this right eye has got an efferent pathway defect. So direct reflex will be absent in this eye and consensual reflex will be absent in this eye. So direct reflex means what does it mean? When you throw light into the same eye, there's constriction of pupil on the same side. That is direct reflex. When you throw light in the opposite eye, there's constriction of pupil in the other eye. That is known as consensual reflex. So as the efferent pathway is defect, there is the muscle itself or the nerve itself is paralyzed. Both direct and consensual reflex are damaged or absent here in case of an efferent pathway defect. Okay, and Wernicke's hemianopic pupil, when light is thrown on the seeing area of the retina, there is some constriction of the pupil. When light is thrown on non-seeing area, there is no constriction of the pupil. That is seen in case of optic tract lesions. Okay, and not in case of lateral geniculate body lesions, because from the optic tract, the pupillary fibers deviate and they go into the pretectal nucleus. And then this Marcus Gunn pupil is what they ask you in your exams. It may be a 2 marks or a 4 marks question. It is very important. So what we have taught till now is constriction of the pupil. So this part you have to take a little care. So what is this Marcus Gunn pupil is? So you know about this light reflex. What is this light reflex or what is this pupillary reflex? Whenever you throw light into the eye, there is constriction of the pupil. That is known as light reflex. when you throw light into right eye, suppose there is constriction of pupil in the right eye, that is known as direct light reflex. And when you throw light into the right eye and there is constriction of pupil in the left eye, that is known as indirect or consensual light reflex. So basically, pupillary reflex or light reflex. What does it mean is when you throw light into the eye, there is constriction of the pupil. So when you throw light into the right eye and there is constriction of pupil in the right eye, that is known as direct light reflex. When you throw light into the right eye, there is constriction of pupil in the left eye, that is known as consensual or indirect light reflex. So that is known as Marcus Gunn pupil. Okay. So in Marcus Gunn pupil, what happens is this direct light reflex is abnormal. Okay. So remember that in Marcus Gunn pupil is a condition in which the direct light reflex is abnormal. That is, when you throw light into one eye, there is improper constriction of the pupil in that particular eye. But the consensual reflex is normal. That is, suppose you think that the right eye has got a Marcus Gunn pupil. For example, if you see the right eye has got a Marcus Gunn pupil, what happens is the direct light reflex is abnormal here. When you throw light into the right eye, there is poor constriction of the pupil. The constriction is abnormal. But when you throw light into the left eye, there is good constriction of pupil in the right eye. That is, the consensual reflex is normal, but the direct reflex is abnormal. So that is what known as Marcus Gunn pupil. This is due to defective efferent pathway that occurs in optic neuritis and other conditions where the impulses are not properly carried to brain. So what is this? Again, we will see in a diagram. Okay, it is diagnosed by test known as swinging flashlight test. So what is this? We will see. So see in this diagram. So basically, till now you are clear with the concept that there is a thing called as a pupillary reflex. Pupillary reflex is also known as light reflex. So what happens is this light reflex is when you throw light into the eye, there is constriction of the pupil. So that is known as pupillary reflex or light reflex. So now there are two types of conditions here. When you throw light into, suppose, right eye, there is constriction of pupil in the right eye. That is known as direct light reflex. When you throw light into the right eye, there is also some constriction of pupil in the left eye. So that is known as indirect light reflex. Okay. So basically, light reflexes are of two types. One is direct and the other is indirect. So direct light reflex is when you throw light into the same eye, there is constriction of pupil in that particular eye. That is known as direct light reflex. When you throw light into the right eye, there is constriction of pupil in the left eye. That is known as consensual or indirect light reflex. So up to there, you are clear. So now you see, here it what happens is, so suppose here you see, here the left eye is abnormal. In this condition, the left eye is abnormal. Okay. So here you keep in your mind that this left eye is abnormal and right eye is normal. So what happens is when you throw light into the right eye, so when you throw light into the right eye is normal. OD means right eye, oculus dextrus. Dextro means right, dextrus means right. So oculus dextrus means right eye. And OS means oculus sinistrus, S-I-N-I-S-T-R-U-S, sinistrus means left. So basically, these are the terms we use in ophthalmology, OD and OS. OD means oculus dextrus, dextrus means right eye. OS means oculus sinistrus, S-I-N-I-S-T-R-U-S, oculus sinistrus means left eye. So here, the right eye is normal in this patient. So when you are throwing light into this right eye, what happens is the right eye pupil is constricting because of direct light reflex, and the left eye pupil is also constricting because of consensual light reflex. Okay, I hope now you are clear about this direct and indirect light reflex. So in this patient, the right eye is normal, left eye is abnormal. So how do you test this? With the help of a test which is known as swinging flashlight test. Swinging flashlight test. In swinging flashlight test, what you do is you take a torch light and you put light over one eye. You put light over one eye. And you count 1, 2, 3. After that, you slowly count 1, 2, 3, and slowly you shift the torchlight to the other eye, and again you count for 3 seconds. 1, 2, 3. And then again you come back. You wait for 3 seconds and you throw light on the right eye and you count 1, 2, 3. So that is how swinging flashlight test is done. Okay. There is a condition in a swinging flashlight test. There is a test. So in this test, what happens is throw light into one eye, wait for 3 seconds. After 3 seconds, throw the light into the other eye, wait for 3 seconds. And after 3 seconds, again come and throw the light into this eye. So that is our swinging flashlight test is done. So what is your inference from this is, so here the right eye is normal, left eye is abnormal. I'm repeating it many times because it is very confusing. Okay. So this right eye is normal here. So when you are throwing light into the right eye pupil is constricting because of direct light reflex. And similarly, when you are throwing light into the right eye, the left eye pupil is also constricting or contracting because of this indirect or consensual light reflex. Up to that you are clear. So here the right eye is normal. When you throw light into the right eye, there is constriction of pupil in the same eye as well as constriction of pupil in the opposite eye. In the same eye, it is because of direct reflex, and in the opposite eye, it is because of indirect or consensual light reflex. That is point number one. So now I want to test whether this left eye is normal or not. So now what I did is, after 3 seconds, I threw the light into the left eye. I took the torch light towards the left eye and I threw light into the left eye. So now what you are observing is, here you see, when you are throwing into the left eye, the pupil in the left eye is not constricting. That means the direct reflex is abnormal here. Okay. And similarly, the consensual reflex. See, here the consensual reflex in the other eye is also abnormal. It is also not constricting fully, or it constricts very little. Okay. So here you see, it is constricting only partially. It is not as much as the case of this eye. So in this way, what happens from this, what we can know is that there is an afferent pathway defect. Okay. So here you see, this right eye is normal. So when you throw light into the right eye, this right eye is constricting normally. Left eye is also constricting normally because of direct and consensual, both are normal here. But here what happens is, when you are throwing light into the opposite side, the direct reflex is also little abnormal in the left eye, and it is all the consensual reflex is also abnormal here. So now here you see, if you take this right left eye, so in left eye what it is happening is, the direct reflex is abnormal, but the consensual reflex is normal. Okay. So in this left eye, what is happening here is, direct reflex is abnormal. When you are throwing light into the left eye, the pupil is not constricting totally. So the direct reflex is abnormal, but the consensual reflex is normal in this left eye. So that is the definition of our Marcus Gunn pupil. So in Marcus Gunn pupil, what I told is, direct pupillary right reflex is abnormal. So when you throw light into the same eye, it is not contracting or constricting fully, but the indirect light reflex is normal. That is, consensual light reflex is normal. So here you see, here this left eye is abnormal. So as per our definition, direct reflex should be abnormal. You say here the direct reflex is abnormal. When you are throwing light into the same eye, left eye, which is abnormal, it is not constricting fully. But the consensual reflex in this left eye is normal. That is, when you throw light into the right eye, this left eye is constricting normally. This means, what is your inference from this? The efferent pathway, that is the oculomotor nerve, the sphincter pupillae muscle, ciliary ganglion, and all these are normal. But there is only an efferent pathway defect. That is, the light impulse is not properly being carried up to the pretectal nucleus. That is where this phenomena is happening. Okay. So Marcus Gunn pupil is nothing but direct reflex is abnormal, but consensual reflex is normal. In this example, this right eye is normal, left eye is abnormal. When you throw light into the right eye is constricting, left eye is also constricting. This is direct in the right eye and consensual in the left eye. But when you throw light into the left eye is not contracting and the right eye is also not contracting. So that is, the direct reflex is absent here and consensual is also poor here. So now, as per our definition of Marcus Gunn pupil, any eye in which direct reflex is abnormal and consensual reflex is normal, like in case of this left eye, these two diagrams, that is known as Marcus Gunn pupil. Why it happens? It happens because of your efferent pathway defect. That is, either a lesion in the retina or lesion in the optic nerve or optic tract, or any efferent pathway defect. Because it is an efferent pathway defect, why we are saying? Because when you throw the light in this eye, everything is normal. That means the motor part or sphincter pupillae, everything is normal here. But only when you throw light in this eye only, you are getting a problem. That means there is some problem with the efferent limb, that is the optic nerve. Okay, if it was some lesion in the pretectal nucleus, then both eyes should be affected. If it were a lesion in the efferent pathway, oculomotor nerve, both eyes should not constrict. But as only the one eye is happy, it is happening like this, so it is an efferent pupillary defect. Again, when you throw the light on the normal eye, right eye, again it is constricting normally. So this thing you have to revise so many times, it is very confusing to understand. Okay. So what are the causes of this Marcus Gunn pupil? Optic nerve disorders, unilateral optic neuropathies like optic neuritis, glaucoma, or iatrogenic, any orbital sinus or plastic surgery, orbital hemorrhage, neurosurgery procedures, or retrobulbar anesthesia, etc. And amblyopia. I told you in your squint classes, amblyopia is partial or total unexplained visual loss with no organic pathology. So unilateral amblyopia can cause a mild RAPD in that particular eye. And then retinal disorders. Usually retinal disorders do not produce RAPD unless they are very severe. Ischemic diseases like CRVO, CRAO, BRVO, retinal infections, retinal detachment. But all these should be very severe in order to produce RAPD. Okay. And next thing is Argall-Robertson pupil. This is one more special entity. So Argall-Robertson pupil means, here you remember that ARP. So A for accommodation, R for reflex, P for present. So in Argall-Robertson pupil, what happens is, accommodation reflex is present, but light reflex is absent. Okay, I told you there is a light reflex, direct and indirect light reflex, that is constriction of pupil while you throw light into the eye. At the same time, there is a condition known as accommodation reflex. What is this accommodation reflex? Is when you put your finger at a far object and when you see, suddenly look at a near object, there is convergence of the eyeball and there is constriction of the pupil and increase in anterior curvature of the light. So in Argel-Robertson pupil, what happens is when you throw light into the eye, there is constriction of the pupil. But when you look at a near object, that is when you accommodate, there is no constriction of the pupil. Okay. So Argel-Robertson pupil means accommodation reflex is present. So here what happens is when you look at a near object, there is constriction of the pupil. But when you throw light, there is no constriction of the pupil. So light reflex is absent, accommodation reflex is present. This will be asked as a 2 marks question. So just you remember ARP, the mnemonic is accommodation reflex is present. So when you look at a near object, there is constriction of the pupil. But when you throw the light into the eye, there is no constriction of the pupil. That thing you have to remember. Accommodation reflex present. That point you write, you will get 2 marks. Okay. In this, both the pupils are involved because this is a bilateral phenomena. And when you put some mediatics like atropine, etc., they dilate very purely. There can be generalized iris atrophy in case of neurosyphilis cases. In case of neurosyphilis, Argel-Robertson pupil was most common. And in that case, there is iris atrophy. Okay. Because light reflex is absent, the pupil is not constricting. So it goes into diffuse atrophy. So generalized iris atrophy. So why it happens? It is said that it is postulated, it is still in a hypothesis that the near reflex pathway, that is when you look at a near object, there is constriction of the pupil. That pathway of the pupillary reflex is more ventrally located than the pretectal nucleus in the midbrain. So basically I told you pretectal nucleus is the center for the pupillary reflexes. The pretectal nucleus is located in the midbrain. Okay, so here what happens is the near reflex constriction of the pupil pathway, that pathway is not fully elucidated. It is expected that it is still hypothesized. It's a hypothesis that the near reflex pathway is located somewhere dorsally and the pupil reflex pathway is located ventrally. That's why any dorsal midbrain lesions will lead to Argel-Robertson pupil, because the ventral pathway is normal, the light reflex will be normal, but this accommodation reflex pathway, which is more ventrally located, there is a problem with that. Okay. So here light reflex is absent and accommodation reflex is present. But this is all a hypothesis. You don't go into details, you'll get confused. Just to remember that accommodation reflex is present, light reflex is absent. Both pupils are involved and dilate purely to midriatics. The near pathway is more ventrally located and then the light reflex pathway. So when there is a dorsal midbrain lesion, the light reflex is gone. But the accommodation reflex, as it is located more ventrally, it is still acting. So accommodation reflex is present, dorsal light reflex is absent. Okay, and there is no clinical condition with the reversing. That is, light reflex is present, near reflex is absent. No such clinical condition has been identified till now. And if anyone identifies that, you will be definitely getting a Nobel Prize for that. Okay. And what are the various causes of ARP? So neurosyphilis, advanced diabetes mellitus, tumors of the pituitary gland, midbrain lesions, Paranoid's dorsal midbrain syndrome. I told you light reflex pathway is located ventrally and accommodation reflex pathway is located dorsally. That's why dorsal midbrain syndromes, they lead to Argel-Robertson pupil. That is, direct light reflex is gone, but accommodation reflex is present. Similarly, myotonic dystrophy, AD stonic pupil, familial amyloidosis, peripheral neuropathies, alcoholism, Charcot-Marie tooth, aberrant regeneration, and all these many things. And here you remember the pseudo-Argel-Robertson pupil. Pseudo-Argel-Robertson pupil, it is seen in case of aberrant regeneration of cranial nerve. That thing you remember, it may be asked in your PG. What is pseudo-Argel-Robertson pupil? There is an aberrant regeneration of the third cranial nerve. That is known as pseudo-Argel-Robertson pupil. So here what happens is because of miswiring or miscommunication between the third nerve and the sphincter pupil, the light reflex is absent. And instead of going to light reflex, those pathways divert and the nerve roots regenerate into the accommodation reflex pathway. That's why causing this kind of a condition. Okay, that was about ARP. Next, AD stonic pupil. AD stonic pupil is post-ganglionic parasympathetic pupillar motor damage. So what is this AD stonic pupil? Is in the pupil reflex diagram, I told you there is a structure called ciliary ganglion here. So this, from this oculomotor nerve nucleus, that is Edinger-Westphal nucleus, the fibers relay in the ciliary ganglion. From this ciliary ganglion, post-ganglionic fibers come and they relay into the pupillary sphincter muscles. So any damage in this post-ganglionic nerve fibers, that is post-ganglionic nerve fibers, when there is any damage, then it causes a condition known as AD stonic pupil. So AD stonic pupil is post-ganglionic parasympathetic pupillar motor damage. That is, the pupillary nerve fibers which are present after the ciliary ganglion, they are damaged. That is known as AD stonic pupil. So there is a denervation supersensitivity in pharmacology. You might have learned upregulation of receptors and downregulation of receptors. I'm not going to go into details of that. So whenever a nerve is not active, or when the nerve is not used for a long time, the receptors present at the nerve terminals come onto the cell membrane. As a result, the number of receptors increases. So there is upregulation of receptors. When there is an upregulation of receptors, even when you give a mild concentration of drug also, because there is a more number of receptors, there is an effect of the constitution of the muscle occurs. That is known as denervation supersensitivity. So that is seen even to 0.125% of pilocarpine. All the details, if you want, you read in your pharmacology. Okay. So the features of this AD tonic pupil are right reflex is absent, near reflex is very slow, and redilatation also very slow. It is like this because the efferent pathway is defective here. As the efferent pathway is defective, it can be unilateral or bilateral. AD tonic pupil, it can be present in unilaterally or bilaterally. Both eyes can be affected. So here light reflex is absent, near reflex is also very slow. There is some vermiform. Vermiform means worm-like, worm. Worms, you know, so worm-like movement of iris. It is usually unilateral in 80% of cases, but still it can be bilateral in 20%. The pupil is slightly large in size because normally in atmosphere we have some kind of light. So when there is light, there is always constriction of the pupil. When you go into dark, there is dilatation of the pupil. Usually we stay in a bright environment. There is always be some light always present, some mobile screen or tube light, something in our room, which will cause constriction of the pupil. So here, as the efferent pathway is defective, postganglionic defect is there, the pupil is normally slightly large because the efferent pathway is defective. It is usually seen in young women, and the knee jerk is absent in these women. So any young woman with a little obese and absent knee jerk and unilateral dilatation of the pupil and blurring of vision, it could be AD tonic pupil. Okay. So how to confirm with supersensitivity? 0.12-0.125% of pilocarpine you apply, and if it contracts immediately, you can come to a diagnosis of AD tonic pupil. Or you exclude other causes in order to come to a diagnosis of AD tonic pupil. Okay. And next, Hutchinson's pupil. What is this Hutchinson's pupil? It will be dealt for you in your general surgery classes, especially neurosurgery part. So this is seen after head injury. So what happens is, after a head injury, what happens, suppose there's a hemorrhage in your brain. Suppose there's an extradural hemorrhage or a subdural hemorrhage or an intracerebral bleed. So what happens is that blood seeps into your brain parenchyma and it irritates the third nerve. So whenever there is a head injury, after a head injury, when there is a bleeding in your cerebral hemispheres or bleeding in your cranium, when there is an intracranial bleed, that blood, what happens is it causes irritation of the third nerve fibers. That is, oculomotor nerve fibers are irritated by this blood because blood is an irritant. Okay, because it has got proteins and all. So blood irritates this third nerve. When the third nerve is irritated, there is a pupillary constriction initially. Okay, so when there is a road traffic accident or some accident or there is a head injury, there is intracranial bleed. There is some bleeding in the cranium. So initially what happens is that bleeding or that blood, blood is an irritant, and that blood, it irritates the third cranial nerve fibers. Because of irritation of third cranial nerve fibers, initially there is constriction of the pupil. After that, what happens is when the bleed goes on increasing, initially when the bleed is very small, it causes irritation. But what happens is subsequently when there is the bleeding is going on increasing, the size of the hematoma is going on increasing. It is some 100 ml, 200 ml, 500 ml. When it is going on increasing, what happens is the intracranial tension rises. There's a raised intracranial tension. So when the pressure in the cranium is raised, it causes compression of the third nerve. Okay. When it causes compression of the third nerve, there is paralysis of third nerve. So when there is a paralysis of the third nerve, the pupil is dilated or fully blown pupil. Okay. So post head injury, what happens is whenever there is an intracranial bleed, when there is a small amount of blood, initially it irritates the third nerve. When the third nerve is irritated, it gets stimulated and it causes constriction of the pupil. That is step number one. But as the bleeding goes on increases, there is raised intracranial tension. When the intracranial tension is raised, it causes compression of the third cranial nerve. When it causes compression of the third cranial nerve, the third cranial nerve is totally blown up and the pupil becomes dilated. So any head injury patient, you always look for the pupillary reflexes. That's why any neurosurgeon or whenever you are posted in a casualty, so whenever you get a road traffic accident patient, always you assess his intracranial tension. Along with the Glasgow Coma Scale also, we assess. If Glasgow Coma Scale is less than 8 or like that, we go for a poor prognosis. So along with the Glasgow Coma Scale, you see this pupil reflexes also. So if the pupil is constricting, that means there is some hemorrhage. If the pupil is going on dilating or it is... pupil is fully blown or it is not reacting. That means there is a heavy intracranial bleed with raised intracranial tension, which needs an emergency craniotomy. So immediately you have to send the patient for a neurosurgeon, emergency craniotomy and decompression, or else the patient is going to die. Okay. because it will the raised intracranial tension will press up on the respiratory center in your midbrain and in your pons and medulla. When the medulla oblongata is also compressed, the respiratory center and cardiac center are compressed. Finally, it leads into cardiac arrest and respiratory arrest. That's why any head injury patient, observe the pupil. If it is initially constricting, followed by dilatation, when it is going on into dilatation, definitely post it for surgery, or else you're going to lose your patient. And then what is this HIPAS? This one you might have all come across in your forensic medicine classes. In your last toxicology classes, there is a condition called aconite poisoning. Aconite is also known as Meta Zeher, okay? Or devil's monk's hood or devil's poison or something. It will be given in your forensic medicine. So in aconite poisoning, what happens is it is a condition known as pupillary unrest. Pupillary unrest means here the pupil is rhythmically spasmodically contracting. So there is a rhythmic movements between the sphincter and dilator pupils. So HIPAS is a condition in which the sphincter pupillary muscle and dilator pupillary muscle both contract and relax alternatively. So as the sphincter pupil and dilator pupil keep on contracting and relaxing, there is a pupillary unrest. The pupil contracts and relaxes, contracts and relaxes. So this can be seen very clearly while testing the direct and indirect light reflexes. So this is the HIPAS. It is seen in aconite poisoning, neurosyphilis, seizures, multiple sclerosis, meningitis, congenital chorea, barbiturate poisoning, etc. Okay. So that was about those classes. And you read those pupillary reflexes and all. We'll see this congenital optic disc anomalies in the next class. We'll see this congenital anomalies for today, 5 minutes, and we'll stop. So that was about the concept parts are completed with that visual pathway defect and your pupillary reflexes. So all your brain work and all these concepts are finished up to there. From here, everything is like biharting type of type. From here, congenital anomalies. So congenital anomalies are like coloboma of optic disc. In your UBI chapter, you might have learned about coloboma of iris. So coloboma is nothing but congenital absence of tissue. Congenital absence of tissue is known as coloboma. It, there could be coloboma of lens, coloboma of pupil, coloboma of choroid, coloboma of optic disc, or any structure in the eye wall can get a coloboma, which means absence of the tissue. So there could be an optic disc coloboma. If it is a minor defect, it is present on an inferior crescent, just like your glaucomatous disc. If it is a major defect, it can be present as an infranasal defect. So this minor defect can lead to hypermetropia and astigmatism. This major defect can lead to defective vision and superior visual field defect. I told you inferior part of the optic nerve and retina subserves the superior visual field. So when there is an infranasal defect, the superior visual field defect is present. The cause of this coloboma of optic disc is defective closure of the embryonic fissure. So defective closure of embryonic fissure is the reason behind this coloboma of the optic disc. Okay? So this is how a coloboma looks like. It will be just like your glaucomatous disc. So one of your differential diagnoses for glaucomatous optic atrophy is congenital coloboma of the optic disc. So it is very difficult to say whether it is due to glaucoma or due to that. Only by other means like visual fields or like raised intraocular pressure and by other means and family history only you can say. And birth history, whether it is present from birth or recently acquired, based on that you can differentiate whether it is congenital or acquired. So it could be, it is a congenital optic disc anomaly, coloboma of the optic disc. This is also one more such thing. It is a coloboma of optic disc along with coloboma of choroid. So here you see this brown color. Usually retina is colorless. Retina doesn't have any color. Retina is usually transparent. But the underlying choroid is brown in color. So the retina gets this red or brown color only because of color of this underlying choroid. So basically the choroid is the only structure which has got some pigmentation, which is brown in color. Retina is a transparent structure. So because of the color of the choroid only, you can see the brown color tinge to the retina. So underlying the choroid, there is your sclera. So in this part, what happens is there is a coloboma of the choroid. I told you coloboma of lens, coloboma of eyelid, coloboma of the retina, coloboma of choroid or coloboma of optic disc, anything can happen. So this is a case of coloboma of optic disc along with coloboma of choroid. So retina is usually a transparent structure, but underlying choroid is a red color structure. Here there is a coloboma of the choroid, that is choroidal tissue is absent. That's why as the choroid is absent, the structure next to that is sclera. So you can see the white color of sclera clearly through this absent choroidal tissue. So this is a congenital anomaly of coloboma choroid associated with coloboma of optic disc. So there will be a visual field defect. If you take a visual field of this person, this part will be having a black color defect in that. Okay, this is a one type of congenital anomaly. Other one is optic disc drusen. Optic disc drusen, it is an intrapapillary. Papilla means optic nerve head, optic or the intraocular part of optic nerve. That is the intraocular part of optic nerve is called papilla. So intrapapillary refractile bodies are these optic disc drusens. This is a differential diagnosis. It is known as pseudopapilledema. Waxy pea-like irregular refractile bodies are present. So here you see this along this optic disc, you can see some triangular some small stone-like structures are present. These are wax-like, small pebble-like structures which are present over the intraocular part, that is papillary part. It is known as pseudopapilledema, and usually it is associated with hypermetropia, and it is diagnosed with help of a B-scan ultrasound. Okay, B-scan ultrasound, with that we can diagnose this. Next, optic disc hypoplasia. It is almost something related to coloboma only, but coloboma is complete absence of tissue. In hypoplasia, some tissue is present, but it is not present in the required amount. Suppose in optic nerve, there are 1 million axons in each optic nerve, I told you, that is 10 lakh axons. But here only some 5 lakhs or 4 lakhs axons will be there. So there is a hypoplastic optic disc. It could be isolated or it could be associated with CNS anomalies, like some pons or midbrain or medulla, something also might be hypoplastic. Or anencephaly, something might be associated with that. It is seen in case of maternal alcohol consumption, diabetes, etc. Here the disc is very small. Usually the normal size of optic disc is 1.5 millimeter in diameter. But here the disc is very small because hypoplasia, there is only few nerve fibers. So it will be around 0.5 mm or 0.2 mm that we can't see. Small disc which is surrounded by yellow pigmented ring, which is called double ring sign. This can be again a PGD. Where do you say double ring sign? In hypoplasia of optic disc, the disc is small. It is surrounded by a yellow pigment ring. So that is known as optic disc hypoplasia. Okay. And then medullated nerve fibers. Medullated nerve fibers means, I told you that usually the optic nerve is not unmyelinated. It is usually surrounded by the meninges. So if there is an abnormal myelination, usually the myelination, if it is present also, it stops at the lamina crepusa. But when the myelination comes outside intraocularly, that is up to the intraocular part of the optic nerve, then a white patch with feathery margins is seen adjoining the optic disc. That is known as the medullated nerve fiber. So normally the nerve fibers of this ganglion cell layer are unmyelinated. Normally the nerve fibers are unmyelinated, but sometimes what happens is they can have an abnormal myelin sheath. So when there is an abnormal myelin sheath, it looks like something like this. This is known as a medullated nerve fibers. You can see so many cases like this in your daily clinic. There is no visual defect with this medullated nerve fibers. It is completely normal. Okay, it is only for a mentioning sake. And then persistent hyoid artery. I hope even in your vitreous chapter and retina also it might have been covered. So persistent hyoid arteries, there are congenital remnants of the hyoid artery system. Okay, so the hyoid artery system, you all might have known this. So in the embryonic time, there is an artery called as hyoid artery which supplies blood to the developing eyeball. Once the eyeball has developed, this hyoid artery gradually disappears. Sometimes it doesn't disappear. When it doesn't disappear, a small part of the hyoid artery can remain here, can remain attached to the past of the part of the lens. So that is known as Mittendorf dot, which causes posterior polar cataract. So this hyoid artery usually disappears by 6 to 8 weeks of gestation, but sometimes this hyoid artery remains, it doesn't disappear. So then what happens is it remains attached to this lens posterior surface, and that is known as a Mittendorf dot. It can lead to posterior polar cataract, and sometimes this posterior end of hyoid artery may remain persistent. That is known as a Bergmeister's papilla. Bergmeister's papilla. These all can be asked as your PG bits. So Bergmeister's papilla is glial tissue at the optic disc, whereas Mittendorf dot is the anterior end of hyoid artery, which presents as the posterior polar cataract. Sometimes the entire vessel may be remained, which presents as a vascular loop. It may remain as a vascular loop. That is about that. Next, morning glory disc. What is this morning glory disc? It is a dysplasia with conical excavation of posterior fundus, which includes optic disc. So blood vessels appear to be increased in number, arise from the periphery of disc, vessels in a straight course over peripapillary area. So what is this morning glory disc? It is dysplasia. So dysplasia is the same, how many numbers of neurons are present, that many are present, but they are present in a disordered growth, somewhere less, sometimes more. Distribution is not correct. So here what happens is, in morning glory disc, something looks like this. Actually, it is derived from the term morning glory flower. This is a flower which is known as morning glory. So see, in this morning glory, what happens here, you see the petals, the gaps between these petals are very straight. They're looking very straight. Okay. And there's a small cup here, small dot here. So here you see this optic disc. In morning glory disc or morning glory syndrome, what happens is there is some dysplasia of this posterior pole, that is along with the optic disc and the macula. The optic disc and macula, entire posterior pole has got some dysplasia. There is improper development of these tissues. As a result, the tissues are arranged in a disorganized manner. So that disorganized manner is such that it appears just like a morning glory flower. So what are the features is, the blood vessels run a very straight course. See this morning glory flower, between the petals, how the blood vessels are running. Similarly, here also you see the blood vessels are running very straight. So this is a morning glory disc. So in morning glory disc, the blood vessels run a straight course over the peripapillary area. They appear as if they are arising from the periphery of the disc. They are increased in number. So in a normal optic CLC, there are few blood vessels. There are only 1, 2, 3, 4, hardly some 8 to 10 blood vessels you are able to see here. And here you see the blood vessels are arising exactly from the center of this physiological cup. So optic disc has got a central depression called as a cup, and the blood vessels arise from this physiological cup. So here you see the blood vessels are in a normal disc. There are only 4 to 8 blood vessels arising from the center, that is the physiological cup, and they are going in a curved pattern here. You see they are bending and all these things. But in morning glory disc, it is completely opposite to that. Here you see they are appearing as if they are arising from the periphery of the cup. They are not arising from the center of the cup. They are arising from the periphery, and they are not 2 or 4. They are more in number. You see here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, almost 15 to 20 vessels you can see here. And there is no bending. Here you see all the vessels are traveling straight, just like your morning glory flower. And all this is because there is disorganized growth of tissue, dysplasia of the tissue. As it looks similar to the morning glory flower, it is known as a morning glory disc. So that is about that. So I hope with this we'll finish here. Congenital anomalies are gone. So in next class, we'll be discussing about this optic neuritis and the neuroretinitis, retrobulbar and all these things. So any doubts? Okay, there are some doubts. Okay, no problem. Everyone is asking my mobile number. I don't know why. Okay. Most of your seniors have my number. Okay, thank you. Hope I'm not fast. If I'm little fast, you please tell me, because I usually tell little fast. I have given my mobile number to some of you. Okay, if I'm clear, that's enough. Okay, so this is about this one. Okay, any more doubts you have? Next class, we'll cover about optic neuritis, anterior ischemic optic neuropathy and all these things. Okay, what is this hour after LNB and before LNB? Once explain that. Okay, what is this lateral geniculate body? Is that actually you have to know about that first order neuron, second order neuron concept. You should be clear about that. I was a little fast there. So what is that? Is nothing. In any pathway, there are actually three types of neurons. Okay, so first you think you take this visual pathway. So in visual pathway, what I told you in my initial class is that there are three types of neurons. Let us go to the retina diagram. There you can understand that clearly. So usually there are things called first order neuron, second order neuron and third order neuron. There are three things. Okay. So suppose in this diagram, it won't be clear. Oh, okay. So in this diagram, you see. So first, there are three things called as first order, second order and third order neurons. Where is the retina diagram? This layers of retina you see. So here what happens is, these cells are called bipolar cells. You know the types of neurons you know in your anatomy: unipolar neurons, bipolar neurons, and multipolar neurons. So here, this one pseudo unipolar neurons, pseudo bipolar neurons also you read in your first year physiology. So here, this is a bipolar neuron. Here you see this inner nuclear, this layer 6 is present. No? This is here, it is labeled as bipolar cell. So this is the first order neuron. This is a bipolar. You see one axon is coming this side and one axon is coming this side. This axon is going into many dendrites. So this is a bipolar cell or a bipolar neuron. That is one thing. Okay. Now what happens is any pathway has got a three orders of neurons. First order, second order and third order. In ENT also the same thing will be there. First order neuron, second order and third order. There it will be from the medial lemniscus. For us it will be the lateral lemniscus. Okay. So in ENT people also they will be telling you what is first order, what is second order, what is third order. Okay. The first bipolar cells is the first order neuron, and from this bipolar cell what happens is it synapses with this ganglion cell layer. So here you can see there is a synapse here. Next what happens is this ganglion cell continues as the axons. The axons of this ganglion cell continue as the optic nerve or optic nerve fiber. Okay, and then this optic nerve fiber what happens is this optic nerve fiber synapses in this lateral geniculate body. From this lateral geniculate body, third order neurons start. So in this diagram you can see. So first order neuron is the bipolar cell which is present in the retina. They synapse with the ganglion cell layer in this retina. So from this ganglion cell, the optic nerve, optic chiasm, optic tract, and this ganglion cell synapse here in this lateral geniculate body. This is the lateral geniculate body. You can see it is labeled here. So bipolar cell forms the first order neuron. From bipolar cells, the ganglion cells come. They come up to this lateral geniculate body and they synapse in this neuron. Lateral geniculate nucleus, and from here third order neuron starts geniculocalcarine pathway. So now what happens here in this concept is that suppose this bipolar cell is damaged, any injury is there, the damage goes only up to here. It doesn't go to this ganglion cell layer. Okay, So when this bipolar cell layer is damaged, it doesn't go to this ganglion cell layer because there is a synapse here. So when the bipolar cell is damaged, there is atrophy only of this bipolar cell but not of the ganglion cell. So similarly, in this lateral geniculate body, what happens is, suppose you think this synapse is the lateral geniculate body and this bipolar cell is your ganglion cell. Suppose you think this is the lateral geniculate body, or we will go to this diagram. So here what happens is, it is synapsing here. So if there is any damage to this part, that is ganglion cell layer, the degeneration of this entire ganglion cell layer axon will occur up to the retina. But here what happens is, when this part is damaged, when this is the geniculocalcan optic radiation is damaged, as it is synapsing here, this damage will not go on to this axon of this ganglion cell layer. That is, the damage will stop from this neuron because it is synapsing. So what happens is, descending type of optic atrophy, that is optic atrophy, will occur only when this one is damaged. That is, the ganglion cell layer is damaged only. As it is in direct continuation, this retina will be damaged. This retina will go into atrophy. But if this optic radiation is damaged, as it is synapsing here, because of the synapse, this damage, this harmful chemicals and all these noxious stimuli don't travel into this ganglion cell layer. So optic atrophy doesn't occur in case of lesions of this lateral geniculate body and above. But from this ganglion cell layer, if there is any damage, there will be optic atrophy. So that is about that. So hope you all are clear. If you don't understand it also, no problem. That we can see in optic atrophy class, in the third class I'll take. If it is clear, next sir is waiting. You have understood, no? Okay, thank you. So any more doubts, we'll see in next class. SPM sir has already come. Okay. Bye for now. Thank you.